There are two types of links. Point-to-point links, which only connect two nodes. We will see an example of a point-to-point link when the host is connected to the Ethernet's switch. The other type of links is a broadcast link. We can understand what broadcast links are from the following example. Assume there are several people in the room that try to talk to each other. The air inside the room is precisely the broadcast link. The goal is that the people would understand each other. We will first discuss the second type of links, the broadcast links. Once more than two people are speaking in a room, we can have a collision, and then it would be impossible to understand what people are talking about. To solve this problem, we need a protocol, which we will call multiple access protocol. It will manage the access to that link and will define who sends data and when. Let's look at the features of an ideal MAC protocol. Given a broadcast channel of rate RBPS, if there is one node that needs to transmit data, then it can use the entire bandwidth and transmit at a rate of RBPS. If there are M nodes that want to transmit, then, on average, they would use their relative part. The algorithm should be decentralized. There should not be a special node to coordinate transmissions. There is no synchronization of clocks, transmission time gaps, and the algorithm should be simple. Let's look at the classification of MAC protocols that manage broadcast links. There are three main classes. The first class divides the links into pieces, according to time slots, frequency, and so on, and every piece is allocated to a specific node exclusively. Therefore, in this type of MAC protocol, collisions cannot happen. The second class of MAC protocols is random access protocols. In this case, the link is not divided. As a result, collisions can happen, and a collision recovery mechanism is required. The third class of MAC protocols is actually the protocols that use features of both previous classes. We will start with an example of the first class, where the link is divided exclusively between the nodes, and the division is done according to time. Each node is assigned a time slot, and in that time slot, only one packet can be transmitted. Here, you can see an example with six nodes that compete for the same link. You can see that the first, third, and fourth nodes want to transmit, and the second, fifth, and sixth nodes don't. This recurs in the following six slots. You can see that if a station has no packets to transmit, then the bandwidth is wasted, and the other nodes that do have packets to transmit cannot use the bandwidth. Another downside of TDMA is that there's a delay until a particular node can access and transmit the packet again. The upside is shared by all protocols of the first class. Collisions cannot happen, and the protocol is very simple. The second example of the first class is Frequency Division Multiple Access, or FDMA. In this case, each node receives its own frequency through which it can transmit. Like in the previous example with six nodes, you see that the first, third, and fourth have a packet to transmit, and the second, fifth, and sixth do not. Like in the previous case, the bandwidth is wasted. But unlike the previous protocol, there is no channel access delay. The previous class of MAC protocols wasn't able to solve the following problem. If we had one node ready to transmit, then it could have used the entire bandwidth. We will look at the second class of MAC protocols that try to solve this issue. They, too, do not require any coordination between the nodes. As a result, collisions may happen. The protocols from this class need to realize how to detect the collisions and how to recover from them. There are several examples of random access MAC protocols, such as Slotted Aloha, Aloha, Carrier Sense Multiple Access, or CSMA, or CSMA with Collision Detection, or CSMA-CD, or CSMA with collision avoidance, or CSMA-CA. Let's look at some examples. The first example of the second class of random access MAC protocols is CSMA, Carrier Sense Multiple Access, which listens before it begins to transmit. If the channel is idle, then CSMA transmits an entire frame. If the channel is busy, then it doesn't transmit. The human analogy, if you remember the people in the room, is not to start talking when we hear someone else is talking. Because the channel is not exclusively divided, collision can occur in CSMA. Let's look at an example of four stations that share a channel. In T0 time point, the second station sees that no one is transmitting, nobody is using the channel, and it tries to transmit its packet. In T1 time point, the fourth station tries to listen whether someone is transmitting in the channel. Still, because of the delay, the fourth station does not detect that a frame was sent from the second station, and the fourth station begins transmission of its frame. And after some time, they both will realize that a collision has occurred. Parameters such as distance and propagation delay play a crucial role in determining collision probability. CSMA-CD is a variation of CSMA. If you remember, in CSMA, before the transmission, the node makes sure that the channel is idle. In addition, in CSMA-CD, during the transmission, the node tries to listen as well. If it can detect a collision, it aborts transmission immediately. This reduced time wasted on the link. Let's look at an example of CSMA-CD algorithm implemented inside the Ethernet. First, NIC receives a datagram from the network layer and creates a frame. On the other side, NIC listens if the channel is idle, and if it is, it begins transmission of the frame. If NIC is busy with another transmission, then it waits until the channel becomes idle. In the third step, if NIC managed to send the entire frame without detecting a collision with another transmission, then, as far as it's concerned, NIC completed the action with that frame. In the fourth step, NIC detects the other transmission, meaning it detects a collision. Then it aborts its transmission. The fifth step is the most interesting one. It's basically the decision when to transmit again. In order to desynchronize other nodes that tried to transmit during a collision, the Ethernet CSMA-CD implements a method called binary exponential backoff. If a particular frame had m collisions, it couldn't be transmitted m times. NIC chooses a number k between 0 and 2 to the power of m-1. And waits for a period of time of k times 512 bit times, meaning k times the sufficient amount of time to transmit 512 bits, and it chooses it randomly, and then it returns to step 2, where it starts to listen whether the channel is idle again. This basically allows to desynchronize other nodes that tried to transmit, and also to implement interesting transmission features. Taking turns is the third class of MAC protocols that manage broadcast links. In the first class, in which we divided the channel into exclusive parts and assigned them to nodes, in the case that all nodes have packets to transmit, then the channel's utilization is 100%. Otherwise, if only one node has a packet to send, the channel's utilization will be 1 divided by n, when n is the number of nodes participating in the channel. In the second MAC protocols class, we learned the situation is totally different. In case every station has a packet to send, we will see collisions every time. And we couldn't even send one packet. Otherwise, when there are few nodes that send packets, then the collision probability is low. You can see it's very different from the first class. The third class, which we will talk about now, is taking turns. It's basically a class that tries to take the features of the two previous classes. We will see two examples of the taking turns class. In the first example, there is a master node that invites other nodes to use the channel. The goal is to reach a stable utilization of the channel, but still, because of the timing overhead, we cannot reach 100% utilization. Besides, there is another downside that can be crucial. If the master node crashes, then either the entire channel is down, or we would need a mechanism to choose the next master. The second example of taking turns is token passing, where we have a special message that is called a token that is sequentially passed between the nodes. In the example that you see, the nodes are connected with a ring, and the token is transferred between the nodes. Each node that receives the token can side a predefined frame maximum, and then it passes the token to the next node. The method's disadvantages are the token's overhead, there is latency still, and if the token disappears, then we need a mechanism to recover the token. Let's summarize everything we've learned about MAC protocols for broadcast links management. We've seen three different classes. The first class, channel partitioning, divides the class into exclusive parts and assigns each part to a specific node according to time or frequency. In case every node has a packet to transmit, then the channel's utilization in the protocols of the first class is 100%. However, the channel's utilization is very low once there are a few nodes that are ready to transmit. In the second class of random access MAC protocols, it's the opposite. They have better utilization when they have few transmitting nodes, because in this case, the collision probability is lower. And once all nodes want to transmit, then we will keep seeing collisions and won't be able to transmit anything. Taking turns is the third class that takes the best features of the two previous classes. And we have seen two examples of taking turns implementations. In one, there is a special master node that invites other nodes to use the channel. And Bluetooth is an example of such a protocol. And another implementation of taking turns is with a token that is sequentially passed between the nodes. We've seen an example of a token ring.